So I'm playing with a lot of these new Windows phones. I have the new Nokia Lumia 900 here. I'm trying to find new things that it can do that my old iPhone can't do. And one of these is I'm looking for something like Siri, but even better. And Ask Ziggy is all about that. We're going to hear about how it works right now. Who are you?
Well, my name is Shai Lieb. I'm the creator and founder of Ask Ziggy. Ask Ziggy is basically Siri for Windows right now. In a couple of weeks, we're going to go out into the Apple and iPad as well. And I've been a developer for about 20 years now. I've always been tinkering with the iPhone and the iPad and different mobile devices. And so I always have interesting ideas for projects. And so this was an interesting idea because there was a need for a voice-based personal assistant on a Windows phone, and so I decided to create one.
Yeah, it's pretty cool, and I think you're the first entrepreneur or startup that's done something first for Windows Phone and then are moving to other platforms, where most of the time I'm hearing about Apple stuff, and then it moves, like Instagram moves on to Android and other platforms. I guess one question people wonder is, how can you do Siri without having that huge research lab, you know, in Menlo Park that built Siri, you know, the SRI lab?
Right. Well, you know, I've been a software developer for about 20 years, and a lot of my project had to do with natural language processing, which is a big part of this. And what we try to do is we try to take natural language, the way that you speak naturally, and we break it down into the different parts of speech. And so the parts of speech, like the nouns, the verbs, the adjectives, and the different phrases that they commonly combine into. And so what we do is we break that down into a language that Ask Ziggy can understand, which is basically broken down into keywords. And then from those keywords, we determine, well, does the user intend to do some kind of a phone task, such as calling, texting, or emailing, or updating their social network status? Or are they looking for some kind of an instant answer for a question that they're posing? And so it could be computational in nature.
Text,
it could be something,
you
know,
the
world over.
It could
be one of the world's questions. It could be about sports, nature, history, geography, politics.
Yeah. This is a free app?
This is a free app. Right now I'm really focused on just getting as much of the user base as I can as possible and just getting people really excited about the ability to do speech recognition as a personal assistant on a Windows phone.
Yeah. When I first saw Siri and they came out to my house a couple of years ago, it was really cool because, you know, you could talk to a phone and it would do stuff, you know. It would get movie tickets and check whether there was dinner available at the Ritz, you know, stuff like that. Right. How compatible are they, or are they compatible at all? Or are they completely different?
No, they're very compatible. There's a lot of overlap. There's some things I do that Siri doesn't do, and there's some things that Siri does really well as well that I don't do. But as far as searching for restaurants, I actually just recently integrated a Yelp search. So now you can search for restaurants, say, I want the best sushi restaurant in my area, and it'll come up with a Yelp search result with the ratings and everything. And so you can call, you can click on the address and start navigating over there. And so you can do that with pretty much anything. You can find a florist, you can find a movie theater. You can even find an auto body shop. So all those things are similar and they overlap with the Siri functionality. But what I try to do is do some additional features that you don't see in Siri. And so one of the things that is pretty cool, a lot of people like, is the ability to go in and split your bill, for example, which is really neat.
So how do you do that? Explain how you would do that.
Yeah, sure. So what you do is you just turn on Ask Ziggy and you say, split my $35.65 bill five ways or three ways or two ways, and you can decide if you want to add a tip too. So you can say, split my bill three ways and add a 20% tip or a 50% tip and whatever you want. And the response will come back and say, each person's contribution is some value, tip is included. So it's a really cool feature, and it's something, you know, when you're in a restaurant where there's a lot of noise, it could be challenging. But if you can get it done, it's actually pretty cool. It saves you a lot of time.
Yeah. How do you prompt it? Like on Siri, you have to push the button and you know,
right.
or hold that main button down and get the Siri interface and then, you know, let it know when you're done talking. Can you talk to it without even touching the phone, or do you have to do something to prompt it?
Well, the current version, you do have to prompt it. You have to click on the microphone. But future versions, we're looking at doing things where we're going to keep the microphone on for a certain period of time. And the user can opt in for doing that because that will use up some of the battery life. But it's something that's going to be useful if the person's in the car.
Yeah.
And the other thing is we're looking at gestures such as shaking or proximity. So you bring the phone up to your ear and it automatically turns on. Very similar to what Siri does right now.
Yeah. The car is where I was thinking about it because in California you can get a ticket the minute you pick up the phone. If a cop's watching you and you pick up the phone, no matter what you're doing, it's a ticketable offense just to be touching the phone. And so we now need technologies that no touching of phones.
Right.
And where we can keep our eyes on the road, you know.
Right. What would be really cool is if we can actually, the Bluetooth does work really well with that, Ziggy. But what I'm looking to do is to see if I can actually initiate the microphone by clicking on the Bluetooth button on a speakerphone or on a headset piece. Yeah. I think that would be great. Because really, that's one of my core principles behind this, is that I want to make this as hands-free as possible and as safe as possible.
Yeah. Now, there's several different Windows phones. We're playing with the new Nokia. You have the Lumia 800, and I have the 900.
Right.
And these are pretty high-end phones. They're not ultra high-end. They're single-core machines, and so they don't have the new quad cores that some of the Android phones have.
Right.
But how much horsepower does your system need, and does it like horsepower? If Nokia came out with a quad-core phone tomorrow, would your system start running better?
Well, you know, maybe there might be a marginal improvement in performance, but the bottom line is there's really a small percentage of the application sitting on the device. Most of it, 90% of it, is in the cloud. And so really the application is more of a gateway into a platform. And so all the natural language processing that we're doing and the recommendation engine analysis is all in the back end. And so really on here you have really a very thin presentation layer that runs on the device. And
so does it work better? Like this phone has 4G, it has the AT&T and LTE.
Right.
That one only has 3G. So does that, because the network is faster, would this work a little faster?
That would work faster with the internet connection, yes. And because we're sort of a widely distributed system and we pull in information from third-party content providers.
Yeah.
And so these are all different connections that have to go over the wire on the internet. So yes, that does help with the performance.
Very cool. Tell me about some of the other use cases that this really works. You told me about tipping and splitting a bill. What other kinds of things are people using it for?
Right. People are using it for stock prices as well. And one of the things that we're thinking about maybe in the future offering as a premium service is the ability to create smart agents. And so you can actually get your entire stock portfolio and you can set up a smart agent that'll let
$51.41.
Rax
New York Stock Exchange, 3:59 p.m. Pacific Daylight Time, Monday, May 14th, 2012.
So how would you talk to the phone? And you would just say, give me the stock price for RAX, which is Rackspace's stock price?
Right. In fact, I pulled that up just about 20 minutes ago.
Okay.
Yeah. So, yeah, that's pretty interesting. Yeah, and you can do that with
$199.45. IBM New York Stock Exchange,
3:59 p.m.
Pacific Daylight Time, Monday, May 14th, 2012.
And this has to do, actually, I saw a picture of you with Google Glass just recently.
Yeah,
and I thought that was really awesome. We are actually working with a company who created a speech-enabled headset, was the first one to do that. It's called Kopin. And we're actually planning on working with them to integrate speech recognition with our headsets. And so right now they have these headsets that are more industrial based, but they're also creating a consumer based headset as well. And so we're going to integrate Ziggy with that. And so this could go into different areas, for example, in industry where if you're an auto technician or if you're in a medical industry where you need to do stuff hands-free and be able to pull information. And so a lot of these companies, they spend $3,000 anyway for a handheld device. And so these devices are going to be not handheld. They're going to be headsets.
Very cool.
Yeah.
So we keep telling me about how I would use this. Wait, give me a couple more use cases of how I would talk to this and get something cool back.
Right. You can say things like, text Joe, let's go grab a beer after work at O'Donoghue's Pub. So you could do that. You could update your Facebook and Twitter status, and you can also look for tweets as well. You can say find tweets on South by Southwest, for example. Other things too is you can find information about just about anything. You could be watching a game show and they could be asking all kinds of questions like who wants to be a millionaire? And you could literally ask the same questions that they're posing and you could find the answers while you're going along. So there's an entertainment part of it as well. I get a lot of feedback from people where they just use it for like 20, 30 minutes straight. You know, like they have a bunch of friends and they just want to find out, you know, what kind of answers they can get.
Yeah.
So there's a fun aspect to it, but also there's a productivity aspect. So I've gotten also a lot of emails from people that want to set up their schedule. And so there's a lot of interest for business people that want to be able to schedule appointments, but based on some kind of priority. So one of the things that we're working on is an algorithm that can actually schedule those appointments based on what they already have, but also on the priority. So there's some demand there for some intelligence behind it to go just beyond the speech recognition.
Very cool. Yeah. Now, when Siri came out to my house, I quickly figured out there were lots of edges, almost like this table.
Right.
And if you're on the table, it's great. You know, if you ask it something it knows, it gives a really cool answer. But if you start asking it something like I asked Foursquare, I asked Siri, you know, how many people are checked in at the Ritz right now on Foursquare? Well, there is an answer to that. You can go to Foursquare and see how many people are checked in. There is an API, and Foursquare has an API that a programmer could talk to,
right?
But it wasn't hooked up, and so it took me out to Google and gave me a stupid answer, right. And I was off off the edge, you know?
Right.
Where are the edges on your service, and how do we avoid hitting them, I guess?
Right. Well, what we're trying to do is we're trying to expand the amount of content providers that we're going to start including into Azzi. So Foursquare is one of the APIs we're going to use. We're also opening up APIs for travel and hotel and renting cars as well. And so we're going to continue adding these things. And so for us, there's really no conflict of interest. I mean, we're going to keep adding as many content providers as possible.
Yeah.
But what's also cool is that if you looked at the database and the information that we're capturing, it's almost like a tiny cross-section of a Google search engine, and it's rapidly growing. So we're actually going to create our own knowledge base as well, based on the information that we're getting and the answers as well.
Oh, that's cool.
Yeah.
That's cool. Yeah. How do you deal with foreign languages or accents? You know, an Australian talks different than a Scottish guy, and a Scottish guy talks different than a New Yorker.
Right. So there's two ways to handle this. One is we're using Nuance for the speech attacks, and they have a huge vocabulary. And so they're able to pick up on the different nuances of accents within the same language. At the same time, what we're doing on our end with the natural language processing is that we're trying to understand what the context of the query is. And so that helps us also be able to get the correct spelling and meaning behind the words, the semantics. I'll give you one example going back to the bill splitter. If someone says, split my bill four ways, oftentimes the speech text comes out with the word F-O-R, and that's nuance. But what we understand is
each
the context
person's contribution
which person
comes to $25.61.
So the F-O-R, we understand that tip that really included. Means the number four. And so we're able to do the computation correctly. So we're kind of hitting it on both angles, both on the speech text with large vocabulary and understanding the context and the intent of the user.
Is there anything that we need to do to our language to make it work better, or does it just understand us no matter how poor an English speaker we are?
Well, you know, just like any other speech recognition application, it always has some challenges, and it's partly related to the hardware as well. And so as the microphones get better over time and the noise cancellation gets better, then it's able to pick up on the signal. Meaning what is a person really trying to say, and not picking up some background random word that's being said near the person.
Yeah.
And so those things will improve over time.
Tell me real briefly, to end up, what's your business like? Were you funded, and what's the fundamentals of the business like?
Sure, yeah. I have early stage funding right now, and I'm also looking for another round of funding because we're looking to ramp up our staff. So we have about two people. I'm full-time. I have another full-time developer as well, and two other part-timers. And one other developer, and the other person is a speech recognition artificial intelligence scientist. And so we're looking to expand on what we currently have. We're looking to improve our algorithms so we can get better. But you know, what we're looking to do is there's different things. We're looking to perhaps monetize based on some of the premium services that we're offering. And this could be with restaurants. This could be with food as well, and travel industry. Yep. And so we're looking to do that. But at the same time, we also are looking to forge these relationships with a company like Kopin. And so there's a lot of interest there to license specialized knowledge bases in different yep. industries, and then using speech recognition as sort of like that glue between the headset and getting the information.
Very, very cool. Yeah. A lot to unpack here. You, by the way, when you started, you mentioned that you're coming out with an iPad version?
Yes, yeah,
is that
in
true?
A couple of weeks. Yeah, yeah,
a couple
of
weeks.
Out. Yeah.
Okay. Is that going to be in beta, or is it going to be actually full blown?
It's going to be full blown. What's making things easier for us is because we're cloud based, and so we can minimize the presentation layer. There's not that much logic that actually sits on the application itself.
Very cool. Yeah. Well, I'm looking forward to trying that, and a lot more people have iPads than yet have these cool new Nokia phones, although AT&T is trying to change that.
Right.
So thanks for what you're doing. It's pretty interesting, and I'm going to try it out.
Cool.
So,
thanks.
By the way, where do we get it and learn more about it?
Right. You can just go to the Windows Marketplace right now. It's free. Oop.
Yep.
And you can just download it for free.
And it's called Ask Ziggy?
It's called Ask Ziggy, and it's under Tools and Productivity, but you can find it anywhere just by searching for it.
Very cool. Thank
you. All right. Thanks.